program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
Welcome to Characters in the Arts once more. I don't know why it is that people love villains far more than they love innocent people, but villains in all forms, shapes, etc., have been personified in the great arts. There are so many ways to consider villains and villainy, that fearful concept of moral depravity which incites fear, anger, and a host of other emotions and different kinds of reactions. But let's take the graphic arts first and see how they do it, how they instill villainy in all of us. Strike back. Eyes twinging with fear and hatred consume this Goya character as he attacks his adversaries. The almost hypnotic glare of the eyes in part only captures the intensity of the emotions generated. But Goya, being the artist that he is, cannot escape the details which bring this character to life. The ragged jacket with the patch on the pocket, the torn open shirt, and the reduction to essence alone in the detail, in features, in his face. Villainy cries out. The evocation of evil in this witch's Sabbath is as much an insight into the villainous machinations of our own minds as it is a graphic depiction of that image. That we evoke decay and depravity out of our own thoughts is a vile enough commentary on our own human frailty. But to see it is almost to feel it. And it is in this genius in Goya that we can almost feel the canvas throb with the life of his characterization. The paradoxical inclusion and removal of detail, the feeling that there is everything and nothing in capturing the fright of viewing this weird celebration of the witch's Sabbath. It's almost beyond belief. Carousing around, that self-indulgent, self-destructive, ego-centered act is all too clearly captured by Hogarth. The rake's progress is really villainous degradation, a pitiful kind of self-inflicted decay. The vivid color is only one small detail in the incredible minutiae with which Hogarth invokes and involves himself. For sometimes it is the detail of room decor, style of dress or disarray, which in conflict with the formality of a period's pose or image, brings out the emotional impact of the conflicting elements. The pity, the sadness, the revulsion of man's inhumanity to man is unbelievably provoking and strong in this Gericault canvas. In searching my own soul, I can't help but respond to the horror, the frightening sense of peace which consumes the head to the left, the almost demented, numb expression from the other head which seems to leap out of the canvas. Gericault, like Goya, strips the canvas of unessential detail, leaving the viewer with no distractions from the villainous perversion which consumes the canvas. When shall we three meet again? In thunder, lightning, or rain. I can really recall the shudder of fear which coursed through my body when I first heard those fearful Shakespearean words opening the play Macbeth. Decamps almost loves his own villainous creation, for his ladies are transfixed before the glow of the golden light of the fire. But this is not a softly glowing fire. Its emanations are as much a presence in this canvas as the ladies themselves. Sometimes intimations of horror far outweigh the depravity of a cleanly etched painting. The suffusion of light which lingers heavily over the mutilated bodies only hints at the villainy inherent in war. And Goya serves art and reality well in this mastery of understatement. For nothing but nothing can match imagination and our minds, which, so to speak, fills this scene with the depravity as it is suffused in its amber glow. But if understatement carries with it an aura of emotional power, the explicitness of the overt act of villainy, the fearful confrontation with murder, human indifference to life and to death, these smash between the eyes with withering impact. The stages of impending death, death achieved, and the death struggle are too much, and yet perfectly balanced in this powerful statement of Goya. Thou shalt not drink, thou shalt not carouse. If somehow the viewing ladies who lean from the front and the side of the canvas could talk, I wonder with what dispassion they would convey their boredom with such carryings on. All of us at one time or another fantasy, cutting up, let's tear about a bit, hang one on. But those who act it out must appear as depraved as this poor rake, and not quite as the bravado-like hero, the image that he possibly has of himself. The death of Marat, as painted by David, is as much a towering achievement in art as it is a devastating commentary on the political situation in France at the time. The perversity of killing him in his bath, which he so needed because of his physical affliction, almost makes the mind expand to take in and comprehend the horror. But equally monumental in the canvas is the beauty of the canvas itself. The beauties of form, composition, color, shadings, and last but not least, the genius of putting it all together. What we have seen, we titillate and we respond to. Brushstrokes convey meaning to us. But words can be equally as dynamic. Shakespeare must have thrilled when he created evil in Iago, villainy there, because to create a Desdemona, to create a sweetie, a confused woman who couldn't understand all the terrible things that were going on, she was just pint-sized in stature next to the enormously evoked stature of this man Iago, this villainous incarnation. But the way that Shakespeare could do it with words, as we will experience in a few moments, the way he could titillate and create brushstrokes out of actual meaning, these are the genius of drama as an art form which can capture equally as well the villainy of villainy. If we take some parts of Iago's own speech, he speaks of Desdemona violently being in love with the Moor. After all, Otello brags about his own conquests, etc., and she's taken in by this. And he says, yeah, but will she really love him when he's no longer bragging? When the hot passions of love cool, what's left in that relationship? The way he can play with words when he evokes the picture of Cassius. Now, Cassius is a man really with beauty of form. And for Shakespeare to write, and he said, he has an eye that can stamp and counterfeit advantage, though true advantage never presents itself. Now, that's poetry. To be able to take that concept of the man literally selling himself in his own presentation is beautifully detailed in words, very much the same way that one would appreciate decor, setting, color, shape in painting. He speaks also of Cassius when he says that in him folly and green minds look after. Wonderful, colorful use of the English language. In other words, although they be words, they have the same power in their own way to evoke the emotional reactions to a villainous character. He's furious at the idea that Othello, the Moor, and Desdemona put their lips close together almost as if to kiss through the air. And to word it that way, when he says that they met so near with their lips that their breaths embraced together. In the following scene, Robert Ward evokes the kaleidoscope of villainy in all its richness as Iago. Quite often, Iago is pictured as a small, almost weasel-like incarnation of evil. As Bord portrays the villain, the physical power of his very presence creates an entirely fresh and vibrant image of that great character in the arts. This, then, is Iago.
Lay thy finger thus, and let thy soul be instructed. Mark me with what violence she first loved the Moor, but for bragging and fantastical telling of lies. And will she love him still for prating? And let not thy discreet heart think it. Her eye must be fed. What delight shall she have to look on the devil? When the blood is made dull with the act of sport, there should be again to inflame it and to give satiety a fresh appetite. Loveliness in favor, sympathy in years, manners and beauty is all which the Moor is defective in. Now, for want of these required conveniences, her delicate tenderness will find itself abused, begin to heave the gorge. This relish and abhor the Moor, very nature will instruct her in it and compel her to some second choice. Now, sir, this granted, as it is a most pregnant and unforced position, who stands so eminent in the degree of this fortune is Cassio. A knave, very voluble, no further conscionable than in putting on the mere form of civil and humane seeming for the better compass of his salt and most hidden, loose affections. Why, none. Why, none. A slipper and subtle knave, a finder of occasion that has an eye can stamp and counterfeit advantages, though true advantage never present itself, a devilish knave. Besides, this knave is handsome, young, and hath all those requisites in him that folly and green minds look after. A pestilent, complete knave, and the woman hath found him already. I know thou canst not believe it in her. Thou thinkest she's full of most blessed condition. Blessed fig's end. The wine she drinks is made of grapes. Blessed pudding. If she had been blessed, she would never have loved the Moor. Thou not see her paddle with the hand? Didst not mark that lechery by this hand an index and obscure prologue to the history of lust and foul thoughts? But they met so near with their lips that their breaths embrace together villainous thoughts, Rodrigo. When these mutualities so marshal the way, hard at hand comes the master main exercise, the incorporate conclusion. But fish, sir, be ruled by me. I have brought you from Venice and watch you tonight. For the command, I'll lay it upon you. Cassio knows you not. I'll not be far from you. Do you find some occasion to anger Cassio, either by speaking too loud or tainting his discipline, or from whatever course you please, which the time shall more favorably minister? Sir, he is rash, very sudden in choler, and haply with his truncheon. It may strike you. Provoke him that he may, for even out of that will I cause these of Cyprus to mutiny, whose qualification shall come into no true taste again but by the displanting of Cassio. So shall you have a shorter journey to your desires by the means I shall then have to prefer them, and the impediment most profitably removed, without the which there were no expectation of our prosperity. Very well. We'll meet later at the Citadel. That Cassio loves her. I do well believe it. And she loves him, tis apt. And of great credit. And the Moor, albeit that I endure him not, is of a constant, loving, noble nature. I dare think he'll prove to Desdemona a most dear husband. Now, I do love her too. Not out of absolute lust, though peradventure I stand accountant for as great a sin, but partly led to diet my revenge, for that I do suspect this lusty Moor hath leaped into my seat, a thought whereof doth like a poisonous mineral gnaw my innards, and nothing can or shall content my soul till I am even with him. Wife for wife. Or failing so, yet that I put the Moor at least into a jealousy so strong that judgment cannot cure, which thing to do of this poor trash of Venice, whom I trace for his quick hunting, stand the putting on, I'll have our Michael Cassio on thy hip. Abuse him to the Moor in the right garb, for I fear Cassio with my nightcap too. Make the Moor thank me, love me, and reward me for making him egregiously an ass, and practicing upon his peace and quiet, even madness. 'Tis here, but yet confused. Knavery's plain face is never seen till you.
Where music takes over at the moment that words leave off, you say, and what could Verdi, who set Otello in music, in sound, what could he do to it that Shakespeare had not already done? Because you have now experienced a form of villainy that's monstrous, but it's monstrous in the understatement. There are bursts in which Iago rises to heights in the character Shakespeare drew him. But essentially, it is the inward Iago, the seething. But as Boito, the librettist for Verdi, said it, he now has the voice quivering with passion. Verdi, who used to create all his scenes by using the orchestra like one big banjo, no longer uses it that way. For Verdi had changed. He had grown as an artist, and to bring his concept of Iago's credo, when Iago sings, I believe in a cruel God, that's what Boito set for him. Now that invocation on Boito's part, he said, these are the words, now you evoke villainy for me. Now, we have stereotyped concepts of villainy. There is the villainy that we all know. not only that. You say, yeah, what has that really got to do with it? But it has a great deal to do with it. Because when Verdi sets the great theme of Iago, he uses open chords the same way. And we hear this. And with that power, the same opening spacing, a kind of monolithic strength. But it's an all outward pouring with Verdi. It's not at all playing around with subtleties of understatement. It's all, as Boito wrote, a filthy slime which he pours out. These are the words which Iago speaks out, but in song he says, go then to thy doom, thou art going. Thy demon, 'tis that drives thee. He's speaking of Othello being driven. And it is I, that demon, and I, in turn, am driven by ruthless fate. Fate whose iron hand controls me. So Iago considered himself in the service of the devil. Mine is a cruel god, who in his likeness fashioned me, and whom in wrath I worship. 'Twas some vile germ that spawned me, spawned evil Adam. And in between each of these imprecations which he throws out, spawn me, he has Verdi do. So the whole thing seethes and palpitates. It just is vibrant now. When he says, I'm a villain, he said, the ancient slime, I feel it of my breed of villainy. And he says, firmly do I believe, e'en as a penitent soul at the altar that prays, that all mine villainous thoughts and deeds are prompted by fate. Now, the statements and understatements of Shakespeare do really not happily apply to Iago as they do to Verdi, the way Verdi conceived Iago. In fact, it should be immensely interesting for you right now to compare your emotional reactions as the powerful statue of Richard Mealyus now creates the immortal aria, I Believe in a Cruel God, by Verdi.
Ci spinge il tuo demone, e il tuo demon son io, e me trascina il mio, nel quale io credo in esser nato il figlio. Come tanta derision, la morte.
Identity in all of us with that kind of villainy, that kind of outspoken horror. Whether we fantasy it or act it out, I'm sure it's there. But in the same sense as you could have the same villainy in dance as in the Ballet of the Red Shoes, we find that there are other characters in the arts. Because here you saw an enormous Richard Mealyus, an enormous Robert Ford create two visions of this evil character. But we have characters with as much diversity in, take heroes, for instance. What is a hero? Is he in baseball? Is he in football? Is he in history? Is he in battle? There are all kinds of viewings of heroes, and it is to that kind of a character that we shall give all our attention at our next viewing. Thank you, then, for being with us. Thank you.